final form exception prints this and returns null. How you can now the thing is, okay, I want to test the file not found exception. Of course, one thing that you will do it with Mosquito will be mock web writer. You will do mock web writer when open, when I call open file, then throw file not found exception. This is one way. Also, you could tap and say when I call open file, I blindly throw file not found exception. But we can do it with Bytemon. Bytemon requires a runner. Again, mock. This is because you can avoid this if you want to use a Java agent. If you configure Bytemon with Java agent, then you don't need to use the runner. But in this way, you don't have to, you know, do all this complicated stuff of configuring the Java agent and so on. And it also works pretty well with IDE. And what I do here is adding a rule with this annotation, the end rule, and say, this is the name, so it's different things, and I said, when I call file output string, the target method file, which means it's a constructor, then throw new file not found exception, and it says, haha, but I don't call you again. Then I can create the new web writer, I'm not doing any mock thing, call the open file, and I am asserting that yes, it's null. And this works. And it's quite interesting. It's null, and if you see the stack trace, you will see that here it says haha Bytemon fully again. Because what you have done is a bytecode modification at runtime. At runtime, you will Bytemon will check this condition, will find it the bytecode and change that bytecode for this bytecode. And that's it. What's the advantage of this? Is that now you are still testing this part of the code. Because if you mock this thing, then you will need to write another test that doesn't mock this, and you need to say, okay, I need to create, I need to pass a file that doesn't exist, and then check that this happens. So you need to write like two tests, like this. In this way, you are doing in only one test. And of course, you can use it. It's a really a big framework, Bytemon. You can do a lot of things. You can also test race conditions. You can say, okay, when I execute this method, I stop and change the thread. Instead of saying wait and notify, you can say, okay, when you execute this test, wait, pass the executor to another thread, and then execute that, and when you arrive at one point, return to that other point, so you can start to test. What happens if I execute this line and then this line? And what happens if I do it in any other way? Because since you are doing a bytecode modification, you can do wait and notify, whatever you want. Also, it says you can use counter, like, when I pass here for 3 times, then through the new section. So it's quite powerful. But, yeah, it's bytecode. You are starting the world of bytecode modification that runtime would use. Usually a zero. But, it is. Also, one thing that maybe it's not a mocking to the toe, but for me it's exactly like a fake, is using Docker for testing in school. How many of you are using Docker in production? Yeah, these are really prone. Nobody wants to use Docker for it. But you can use it for your test. How? If you need your server, you can take your main server, put it inside Docker, and then in your test, you started your Docker container with your node server, you execute the test, and then stop the Docker container. In this way, you're using your production node server, so you don't have the surprises that you can get with space. The same with if you're using MySQL, then you can create your Docker image with MySQL, start the MySQL, do the test, close it, and so on. And it's quite fast. It maybe takes 2 seconds to file. But obviously, other thing that you can do is using Archilium. Anybody here knows what is Archilium? Okay. I want to explain you. Probably all of you are using an application server, or server container. Maybe Tomcat, Poly, or an application server, Wi-Fi, Blasty, Tom, and okay, you have your test, and I've said that, for example, you're using a Spring, that Spring uses some page dispatch servlet, and you say, okay, but I want to test my application into the application server that I'm going to use on production. And this is what a client does. Basically, in a client, you come to you what application server you want to use. For example, I want to use Tomcat. Okay. Then you come to you what is your deployment file. At the end, it's your work file. And then a client executes and says, okay, and you do the test. I'm going to start your server that you have configured. I'm going to download, start it, put there the work file that you have defined in my unit test. I execute the test. And then I undeploy the application and I close the server. So your tests are running in your application server, the application server that you're going to use on production. Of course, I might say that it's safe because you're running on your machine or in the Jenkins machine, whatever. So it's not exactly the same environment, but it, at least it's the same application server. Of course, the client also has a remote mode where you can connect to a already running application, application server, not production because it's quite risky to execute tests on production, but maybe in your QA environment or your pre-production environment, you can have there your Wildfly running, you connect there, you deploy your test, execute the test on that Wildfly, and then close it. And the good thing is that we're going to see then that it works as a JUnit class. We're going to see. And yeah, we are ending. Finally, okay, we've talked that we have seen a lot of strategies for writing tests for our commit stage, but we need a way to orchestrate all this commit stage, which means getting the code, executing the test, doing the binaries, and so on. And I'm sure that every who here are using something that is not a Jenkins. What are you using? Only for Bamboo. Okay. No, only to know it, and it's not. I'm not a sales manager, so don't worry. Yeah. Well, Jenkins, probably if you are working with it, you will see that when you create a new job, you need to go there and say, new freestyle job. And instead, add build step. I don't know. Maven clean install. Add build step. I don't know what. Add post-build action, publish JUnit results. Fire a new job. You fire another job, and this job contains your acceptance test, and this acceptance test has also all your build jobs there, all. So, and if you want to use another, or you want to create a new project, you need to do exactly the same. New job, blah, 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 or you can use a template, but well, this is another story. That so it's quite a tedious job. So what we are doing in CLAB is doing something that is called continuous integration as code. So if instead of having to do all these UI things, you could program it in your code, it would be perfect because you as a developer would be able to define your pipeline. When Jenkins pull the code, you will get the pipeline that you want to execute. So you can have different pipelines for different projects, and it's the developer, the one is responsible of defining how he wants to build his own application. And basically, if you search in Google, you will find the Pipeline plugin is the one. Basically, yeah, this is a sales management slide that say that, yeah, Jenkins, it integrates with everything. Well, you can see that with stage and deploy, it can run in different clouds, runs in different, or can deploy in different languages and application servers. Well, you can use different things for testing, for build. You can use Sonar, Gradle, Eclipse, even, Jenkins integrates with everything. So how it works, this pipeline as code? Basically in this way. This is a Groovy DSL. So since it's a Groovy, you can do whatever you want here, like a for, a new, I mean, if you know Groovy or not, I mean that at the end any Groovy sentences are almost like Java, you can use it here. And in this case, what I'm doing is defining a stage, which is compile and unit. I define a node. A node is and a slave, a Jenkins slave, where you want to run this task. And then I do a git branch, I get the code, I do a Gradle clean test, and then I stage everything except the build. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to take all the source code and storing in a map with name source. And this map is available for all the nodes. Also, again, I do the same for the JCoco report. And finally, I archive all the test results. So when I go to the job screen, I can see this graph that says the trend of the, you know, if you are introducing bugs or not. Then I added here a stage called code quality, which is going to execute in parallel, which means that it's going to see how many slaves have your infrastructure. If you have two slaves and now three, it's going to execute in two slaves at the same time. Of course, this is a very simple example, which I said, okay, do the PMD report, which is basically, I unstash the source, so I don't have to go to the Git and get it the source code. Also, if someone has pushed something in the middle, I don't have this problem because this is something that is for this build, but it's spread across all the infrastructure. I do the Gradle PMD main, and then finally I publish the PMD results. And in parallel, I'm going to do the Gradle JCoco test report, which creates a report of JCoco. Of course, in this way, if you are in a real project, what I would do is, okay, my commit stage needs some unit tests, but also some integration tests, because I need to be sure that when I finish the commit stage, probably everything will work. Also, let me tell you that the commit stage can take like 10 minutes. So you have 10 minutes. In this time, you can do whatever you want. So it makes sense to add some integration test that checks that your WAR file is correctly done, that when you deploy it in an application server, it's deployed, and you can get all the endpoints. If you are using REST, you can get information of all the REST endpoints, because if not, it has no sense to say, yeah, all my unit tests are working, but when I go to the acceptance test phase, I don't know why, but it fails, because the developer is doing another thing. So it's quite difficult to focus on that fail when you are focused on another task. So it's very important that the commit stage gives you real results. And of course, you can, I create here in a stage which is called assemble binaries. I'm getting a node, and this is it's a stupid example that says, I want to use a node, which is a slave, that is tagged with Linux. So what I'm saying here is, please execute this code inside a Jenkins slave that is a Linux. And I unstash the source, and then I said, with MVM variable source build number, which its value is m.buildNumber, the build number of Jenkins 1, 2, 3 or whatever, I'm setting here, and then I call gradle.assemble. And this is because this script contains an environment reference to source build number. Then I can do something like this, that is input message, deploy application to create, and your build will stop, and you can accept or reject. If you accept, it will execute this part, and if you reject, it will, the build will fail. Notice that in this stage, I'm saying concurrency 1, which means that, of course, if you have a multi-branch project, or you're using a feature by branch, I mean that you have a lot of for each feature, and everyone start to push it, okay, to Jenkins will start to execute all of these things. And if you don't put concurrency 1, it means that the last feature branch, you can deploy something else, and then in the middle deploying another thing, and then in the middle deploying another thing, because all the build is executed in parallel. So when doing this is like, okay, for all my Jenkins infrastructure, I want only one slave being executing this part of code. So you need, when you create the Jenkins file, you pay attention of what you want, what you're doing, because there is a lot of jobs that can be executed in parallel. And finally, you get something like this, which is a map. When you say all the stages, all the average time, this is the average time. So you can, so it's very important, because if you know that here you're executing unit tests and some integration tests, then if you are a developer, say, yeah, normally it takes 5 minutes. And here you will see that this is a timer that is counting. You can say, okay, I'm going to take a coffee. And then when I return, I will know if my commit has break something or not. And if you say here that usually takes 50 minutes, you can go to the your retrospective and say, please, we need to short this time by using more mocks or seeing what's happening. Also, notice here that it's paused for 1 minute. This is the input thing. When you do input, it will say how many times has been stopped. And one thing that, sorry, but it's for the paid version of Jenkins, is this thing, which is a checkpoint. What you can do with the Jenkins file is putting checkpoints. And this means that at any time, you can rerun from that point. So it means that if here, for example, your Jenkins has stopped for something, you can boot it again, push that button, and it will start as if nothing happened. Or if you say, oh, I need to deploy to QA, but the QA environment has been is down, I couldn't deploy it, so this state fails, then you go to the QA thing or the infrastructure guy and say, hey, the QA environment is down. Oh yeah, it's true, I'm going to start it. Start it again, and then you don't need to execute everything again. You push that button, and it's like nothing has ever happened. But this, as I said, is for the paid version of Jenkins. But I'll show you. So, correct, then let's see what we have seen. Let's think about what we have thought. First thing is that unit test should be first. And for me, the most important thing is the F. Of course, isolated is also important and repeatable, of course, and timely. Who can say that first write the unit test and then write the code? There is always one guy. When I ask this question, someone said always someone who did it. Okay, but almost all the people first write the code and then write the test. This is something that happens. Or not all the tests. I mean, they write some basic skeleton test and then write the code and then. So it doesn't matter. The cost is very important, because these tests are executed in the committer state. You only have 10 minutes to execute it. So it's really important that you get it fast and get it as many feedback as possible. We have seen here mock, stop, and fake, and you will say, and what I can use, it's depending on the situation. I cannot say. I would say that at the end, it's always the same pattern. You're using fake for mail services, databases, and in case of you're using a string frame, you're using a stop when you need to verify something that has fake. I usually don't use a stop. Why mock, yes, but creating custom stop usually is not useful. And mock is the most used strategy for mocking things. If you need four mocks, first of all, stop and say, can I change my code? What I'm doing wrong? And then use four mocks. Sometimes you need, because maybe you are using a code that you have not written and you cannot modify, or this code is already in production, or whatever, then bad luck. You need to use four mocks, but if not, think twice. Remember that now we have Docker and can be used as testing. It works pretty fast. Use it. Also, I would like to say that Jenkins is not a static anymore. As we have seen, instead of having to, doing all your build of steps and so on, you can use Jenkins file and everything works automatically. And I've seen this graph that I'm sure that all your managers will be very happy to see this. And I will say why. This is your application. Probably your application is something like this. It gets some input, JSON, HTML, whatever. You parse the input, You read something from DB. You do a, you take a decision. I don't know if this is greater than that, then do I don't know what. Then you say something to the DB. If you are in a bank environment, probably you will do something in the GMS. You create your response and you send the response in the JSON, HTML, or XML. Probably almost the 90% or 80% of the applications are this. So my advice is forget this, forget this, forget this, forget this, forget this, forget this. Because the 70% of the problems are in the golden thing. So probably you don't have time to write tests. It's the reader, huh, it's like, yeah, I would like to, I'm sure that most of you will have the problem of, yeah, we would like to write more tests, but we don't have time. This is typical. It happens in all the companies. So if you don't have time, no worries. Take the test for the real, where the business code happens, and then write an integration test, testing the happy path of all these things. And then if you have time, you can start to write tests for this, for this, for this, for this, for this, unit test for this, or creating an integration test that says, what's happening if I write this and that? Because at the end, I prefer to have 10 tests that it works, that are maintainable, and that help us, than having no tests. Of course, it will be better if I will have all these tests. Of course, this is the ideal scenario, but it's not always possible. And that's all. Any question? There is a construction that you say, first of all, if it returns a void, I will not mock it with when then. Because by default, Mockito returns null. So I will do anything. And since when you init the mock, you're creating a proxy, the proxy is smart enough to say, oh, you have not recorded anything. This return void, okay, I don't do anything. But you can do it with do answer, as it means. Instead of saying when, the construction is do answer, then, and you can, and do answer, you need to implement an answer interface where you can do whatever you want. Nothing. You can do things. Yeah, of course, you cannot return anything, but you can do things. Yeah, but no. I mean that if you return void, you don't need to do anything in the Mockito. You mean for the arguments. Okay, then you do a when, and there is as I said, that you do a do answer, and this if I remember correctly, there is a method that is reserved for void, but it's not doing when then. It's using do answer. I can check it and yeah, okay. But yeah, it you can do it. Yeah, it's called do nothing. Yeah, you can do when no do answer. I don't know what dot do nothing. Yeah, it's true. Do nothing. Yeah, sure. This is a limitation of JUnit. Maybe if you Google someone, maybe has created a Spring Power Mock runner that there are people that do this kind of thing that merge to runners and yeah. But it will be an external project or yeah. What? No. Lightman? Cons are... It's bytecode modification. and it's... Yeah, you, sometimes... I mean, that it's... You need to do it... you need, you know, how it's called in English. It's like Sergey Hen. It's like I'm going to touch this with this, and I'm, you know, it's like, and sometimes you put it wrongly. It happened to me when I executed when I created the demo, and it was like, oh, why is that happening? Or why is it happening in this case? And it's because you don't specify exactly in which point you want this byte comment, and you are putting that code in several classes. For example, in the example I put, you're putting all file or put stream classes in all of them. You can use it in another class, and it will do that. Because it's quite. You need to be really aware of this. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, test ng is different.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Then, any other? Well, I will be here. Well, yeah.
You mentioned this 10 seconds. Where is this comes from? You mean
10 minutes for the committer stage. Well,
it's the limit
of the committer stage phase. Yeah. This comes from the continuous delivery book from Jess Humble. Of course, if you basically it's like, okay, how much time a developer can wait until he start a new task? And it's like 10 minutes, it seems reasonable. You work in something, you push, you go to take your coffee, you return, you say, oh, I have not break anything, okay, I'm going to take the next task. For this is 10 minutes. It could be 15, even 1 hour. But then you will start working on another task. And then, if the build fails, you will say, oh, it fails, what's happening? I have started something, I want to finish this, and I will say that. I mean, it's for this reason. It's not. No. Well, I might answer then. Here, this is the presentation. You can send me an email. You can follow me in Twitter, it's Alex Soto B, and I will send that tweet with the slides and so on. So and also in the slide you will see here all the technologies that I taught. Then let me show you. I'm going to show you this project. Okay, this is an example that I've prepared. I'm sure that anybody here knows what is Swappy. It's a Star Wars API. And it contains all the databases of all the planets, all the vehicles, people, I don't know. People have time to spend some strange things. But it's quite interesting. And now what I'm doing here is a microservice, which connects to that Swappy database. It gets the first 10 planets. It calculates the average orbital time, and it returns to the client. That's quite stupid, but it's useful. As you can see here, my application, this is the JAX-RS, this is the FAB, this planet, I'm injecting the Swappy gateway, which is the basically the class that is used to connect to the Swappy. The Planet service, which does the average thing. Also the decimal format, I am injecting with this qualifier, which is average formatter, which average is two decimals. And then I have here that when I go to slash planet slash rotation slash average, I get all the planets from Swappy gateway. I get the results of this position in this way. I calculate the average and then I return the result of the average. If you want to see the Swappy gateway like this, I'm setting the Swappy URL, and maybe some of you will say, "Oh, you're not putting flavor." Oh, don't worry. This code works. It's going to run inside an application server, and the application server will take care of it. With an application server, you try to inject something that is not private, and you try to do that Swappy gateway dot Swappy URL, then it will fail. Don't worry. Application server takes care of this, and this helps really. Really helps you in writing a test, you're going to see. Then you have a custom struct where I initialize the client builder and I get the Swappy URL, the path, and then the get all planets simply does the request to the Swappy that goes like the URL, this one, not much secret, and the average thing, sorry guys, is Java 8, and basically the data stream dot map link, basically I'm doing here is data is a map. I use a JSON array, sorry, which is a list of elements, and what I'm doing is I want to get the element orbital period. I want to get this element and get it as int. Then the string will take all the int, and finally, as a terminator, I do an average, which is calculate the average in the code. You can do it with a for and getting and so on. You can do it. I don't know why I put that. And finally, I have here the average formatter. It returns a formatter with, as I said, with two decimals. Because it just doesn't have